Today we're going to talk about the Mistborn trilogy, specifically Era 1. Era 2 is separate, and it's good in its own way, but we're just talking the first three books. So Final Empire, Well of Ascension, The Hero of Ages. We're also not talking about The Secrets of Mistborn, which is a novella in the Mistborn universe. I'll talk about that one day, but not today. I recently just reread the trilogy. I loved it. I have two spoiler gush talks for the first two books. If I have somehow found the energy and time to create one for Hero of Ages, I will also link that down below. But Hero of Ages is, I think, now my least favorite in the trilogy, and they're all five-star reads for me, so when you have a least favorite in a sea of five stars, what does that really mean? But I love this series. This video is not just going to be me going, I love this series. I promise I'm going to do a should you reads for it. So I have one of these for the Stormlight Archive, where I try really hard to make sure that this is a trilogy that would work for you, because it's an insanely popular series. Didn't always used to be, but it is extremely popular, so I feel like it could be very easy to get caught up in the hype and pick it up and then realize maybe this wasn't for me. So my attempt with this video is to be like, yes, I love it. Here are the things I like. Here are things that might not work for you. And maybe it will help you figure out, yes, this is something I want to dive into. Because as much as I love it, I can see it not being for everyone. One of the first things I want to talk about that hit me more on this read than in other ones is its setting. I feel like as a kid, when I first read this, because I first read this as a teenager, and then I read this in college, I did not notice how bleak this world is. This is a world where ash is always falling from the sky. There's no color. Everything is like browns and oranges. It is a setting where you have like a feudal system. You have nobles and you have peasants. Like you have a very repressed class of individuals called the Ska. This is not a happy world, and it's never a happy world. It's actually a world that is on the brink of mass chaos at any given point. Not just because of political stuff, but because of in-world stuff. Which, depending on where you are in our current world crises, may or may not vibe with you. I would also say that although this is a very bleak world, it does not read like what a lot of people say is a grimdark book. I feel like we all, when we talk about subgenres and feels of books, know it when we feel it. This does not read like the First Law trilogy or A Song of Ice and Fire, even though there are things that overlap between this series and those. And I think partially that's because of Brandon Sanderson's writing style, which I'll talk about a little bit later in the video. But just up front, I feel like the setting's important to know. Like maybe you don't want to be in that setting. And it's also a different world. So although there's a lot of influence based off political structures we've had on Earth, it's a different world. It follows different rules, and it's kind of, I want to say, lightly Victorian based sort of thing. So if that's not a thing you want to spend three books in, you should know that up front. It's pretty bleak. And another thing I like to mention is that this is a hard magic system. And what that means is this is a magic system that has a lot of rules, to the point where in some ways you could say, well, why isn't this science fiction? Because everything is so explained and seems to follow some fundamental laws of this universe. And I don't really care if you decide suddenly this is a sci-fi series. I do think it has enough fantasy tropes that it would be very hard for a lot of people to put this in the sci-fi genre. I don't really care. But one thing you do have to know is that this is a magic system that would translate very well to a video game. Like, there are rules, they are very hard to break. You might not know all the rules, so maybe that's where some of the mystique comes from. But if you were someone who likes their magic to be more magical or fantastical, that's not a thing here. There are rules. There's basically kind of tutorial mode in the first book, where you kind of are learning with one of our main characters how this all works. And for me, I love that. I really love the inspiration in real life physics that kind of comes through in this magic system, and having a world that's so different, that has its own fundamental laws that I get to learn about as a reader. That's the thing that made me fall in love with this series and every series in the Cosmere, is how structured the magic system is. But as much as that is a positive for me, it's a negative for many people, because and to some extent, I can see sometimes you want your magic to be magic. Like, and that's just not what it's going to be here. But there is so much to discover. So it's not that there's not a lot of discovery going on. Like, all three books, it's just, like, so many cool reveals about this magic system. And it's ever evolving. So it's not like, at least in my opinion, it gets stale or anything like that. But if that's just not your cup of tea, it's not your cup of tea. And who am I to judge you for that? But those are things I like to bring up just because those are things that exist that might be to your taste or not your taste. There's also some tropes that might help you decide if this is the type of story you want or not, and I'm not going to talk about any synopses or spoilers other than for the first book, but you got very strong found family. Like, this first book is a heist story, and like most heist stories, you have a group of people coming together, have to overcome their differences and rely on each other to get an impossible task done. Like, think of Fast and Furious, think of Mission Impossible, right? Like, it's that type of found familyness. And you also have strong Chosen One trope energy. I mean, the premise of the series is this is a world that suffered from their Chosen One failing. And now we're in a new generation, a new time is occurring. Maybe a Chosen One will rise up and help save the day in this scenario. So that's like your classic fantasy trope energy here. I really like both of those things. I think both of those things are executed to the best quality. But if you're someone who doesn't like found family or doesn't like the Chosen One, maybe steer clear. Like, those are the things that I think it does the strongest. So if those are things you don't want, like, I don't think it's going to work out well for you. And I do think the biggest thing that people don't talk about when they're trying to figure out will a person like this story is the writing style and plotting that Brandon Sanderson typically uses. So when I love Brandon Sanderson's stories, I love them because I like him a lot as a storyteller. I think he does a really good job of keeping me engaged through the slow moments, through the fast moments, of obviously having a plan from the beginning, planting seeds that will bear fruit later and in ways that you are like, how did I miss that? That was so cool. Like, it never feels like something happens to be convenient. It feels like everything is earned and well placed in the foundation. I really like that. I value that, and I value the craft he puts into his world building. So those are the things I really like. I like the scientific-based world building, and I love the stories, and a lot of the characters are very relatable to me. This is one of his earlier works, but it still has that mental health representation that people always talk about in the Stormlight Archives, where Vin, the main character, has a lot of anxiety and a lot of PTSD. And that comes through in ways that I didn't even realize I was relating to as a kid. See some of my spoiler chats for more information there. But those are the things I really like. If you were to ask me who has my favorite prose, I do love how accessible Brandon Sanderson's prose are, especially because when I first started reading Brandon Sanderson, I was reading a lot of classic stuff for my school, and I always felt in over my head. I always felt like, why can't I understand these sentences and these paragraphs? And reading Brandon Sanderson, it's very direct. It's very to the point. There's no confusion. I know exactly what's happening, and I love the flow. That doesn't mean it's like beautiful and like winning literary awards, but it accomplishes its goal, and I think it does it more than just accomplishes it. I think it's very accessible. It brings people into the genre. There's a reason why this is so popular. But I also think, you know, there are many people who will pick this up, though, and hear how much everyone loves it and be disappointed if your goal in reading is to be caught up in beautiful prose, because I don't think that's what they are. They are prose that serve the purpose of the story and the characters, but they're not the main highlight. And I think even Brandon Sanderson has said that his prose is not meant to get in the way of the story. It's kind of meant to actually kind of be in the background. And what's funny is, like, in its own way, it kind of becomes his voice, right? He's very kind of just, it's just there to tell the story. It's not meant to be intrusive or anything like that, which works really well for me. But most of the people I know who don't like it, they have an issue with the writing style, and then the plot and the characters are not enough to make up for that experience. So keep that in mind, that if you are someone who is very driven by writing style, maybe you pick up a sample chapter or two and see if it's for you. Another thing that I mention a lot in my Stormlight should you read, and I think needs to be said in almost every Sanderson's thing that I've consumed to this point, except maybe his young adult. His pacing is interesting in a way that works really well for me, but like is, I think, not what people expect with the popularity that this series has. And that is that they kind of start off incredibly slow. Each book is very plodding. And there's, I think, a lot of people pick up The Final Empire and are like, nothing's happening. What's going on? When's it going to pick up? That's like every book is like that. And then at the end of every book is like what is called a Sanderlanch. And it's just like you race to the finish line. And I think that that can be jarring for people. I know for me, I think when I was first reading it, I was very confused going into Hero of Ages after finishing The Well of Ascension, because The Well of Ascension has this huge climax and it's like, oh my goodness, ah, I need to pick up the next book. And then the next book's very like different. And that's like a lot of Sanderson's style when he crafts his stories. And I have gotten used to it. I have been conditioned to like this. But I do feel sometimes when a book has so much hype and so much love, you kind of don't expect it to be imperfect in that way. And I don't think his pacing is perfect. I think it's good, but and serviceable for sure. But be warned that when you pick it up, it is not always a bunch of action. But if you connect to the characters, it's great. Like sitting in the quiet moments, it's fantastic. So those are kind of my overview, spoiler-free thoughts that hopefully will help you decide if you should or shouldn't pick up this series. I love it, and it's definitely a series that I think works well for people who are coming to the fantasy genre or people who have been in the genre and just want to know, why is this so popular? Because I feel like those are the camps these days. It's like, I haven't read a lot of adult fantasy, and this is what people always recommend to beginners, or I've been reading adult fantasy forever, but haven't picked up Brandon Sanderson yet, and he is so popular now, I guess I just need to see if it's for me or what it's about, just because, you know, sometimes when you're in your favorite genre, you just kind of want to know. There have been so many series I've read just so I could have opinions on them. But that's it for this one. If you have any thoughts or questions, feel free to leave those in the comments down below. If you want to leave an emoji, leave like a cloud or mist because of Mistborn. Or I guess if you can't find that, like a volcano with like lava coming out of it for like the ash mounds. And like if you liked it. Subscribe if you want to. And I'll see you in the next one. Bye.